Cannabis Common Sense, the show that tells the truth about marijuana and the politics behind its prohibition.
Hello and welcome to another exciting edition of Cannabis Common Sense. Our show is a production of our nonprofit organization, the Hemp and Cannabis Foundation, or THCF, and our affiliated political committee, the Campaign for the Restoration and Regulation of Hemp, or CRRH. We have an exciting show for you tonight. Mr. John Murphy is here with some nifty embroidery and quilted blankets that feature some of our favorite leaves. And then we also have Henrik Rode, who is an office person at our THCF Medical Clinic, and he's done some public relations here over the past couple weeks. We'll be meeting with them both. Hey, Henrik. Hey, John. And then we always have Mr. Tim Pate standing by. Well, not always, but on the nights we're lucky enough to get him. Mr. Tim Pate, how are you doing, Tim?
I'm good. How are you tonight, Paul?
Very well, very well. Another busy week. And we have the hemp news. We have a few hemp news stories for you tonight. News about marijuana and things that are changing. And we're going to start out, as we always do, with our infamous dancing cannabis leaves. Last week we had a story that we were happy to break here on Hemp News, and it was of such monumental importance that we're going to cover it again. Out of Sacramento, California, the American College of Physicians, or the ACP, the nation's largest organization of doctors and of internal medicine, and the second largest medical association in the country, called for easing the federal prohibition of marijuana in a position paper released Friday, February 15th. The ACP asked the federal government to review the inclusion of marijuana as a Schedule I drug, a classification it shares with drugs such as heroin and LSD. Schedule I substances are declared to have no medical use and a high potential for abuse by the federal government. Since its inclusion as a Schedule I drug in 1970, scheduling of cannabis has constantly been challenged. The conflict between federal law and the 12 states now that medical cannabis statutes have been enacted and have made many doctors avoid recommending medical cannabis as a treatment. Dr. David Dell, the president of the American College of Physicians, said that contributed to the ACP's action. Dr. Dell said, quote, "We felt the time had come to speak up about this. We'd like to clear up the uncertainty and anxiety of patients and physicians over this drug," end quote. Officials at the White House Office of National Drug Control Policy panned the ACP's move. According to Bertha Madras, the ONDCP Deputy Director for Demand Reduction, says what this would do is drag us back to 14th century medicine, end quote. With the ACP now supporting rescheduling, the ONDCP can no longer claim that medical cannabis is not supported by science or the practitioners of modern medicine. With this action, the ACP joins the American Nurses Association, the American Public Health Association, the American Academy of Family Physicians, and many other medical associations calling for cannabis to be made a legal medicine by the federal government. The full text of the ACP's policy paper is available online at www.acponline.org. That's www.acponline.org. From Idaho, in Haley, Idaho, Haley voters will likely have an opportunity this May to once again decide on a series of municipal initiatives seeking to liberalize the city's marijuana law enforcement policies. Haley City Clerk Office reported this week that it had certified four marijuana initiatives to appear on a special May 27th ballot. All four initiatives had been previously decided by voters in November, when Haley residents endorsed language legalizing the use of medical cannabis and hemp and called on police to make marijuana law enforcement its lowest priority. In January, Haley City Council members took legal action to nullify all three voter-approved provisions, claiming that they conflicted with federal law. The sponsor of the initiative, the Liberty Lobby of Idaho, said they would remove the measures from the May ballot if the city officials agree to implement the spirit of the original initiatives. Haley City attorneys previously said that the city is not legally required to accept the outcome of voter initiatives. The drug law reform communities had a huge loss over the past week at the passing of Dr. John Morgan of City University in New York. Longtime marijuana law reform advocate John Morgan passed away last Friday, February 15th, in New York City at the age of 67. Dr. Morgan had been an activist for medical marijuana and marijuana reform, serving on Normal's board of directors from 1995 to 2004, and on the advisory board for Normal afterwards. Morgan died after suddenly falling into a coma in the hours following an unexpected diagnosis of leukemia. Friends and family, some of whom had spoken to an apparently healthy Morgan just days prior, were stunned and saddened. Dr. John P. Morgan was a physician and professor of pharmacology at the City University of New York's Medical School. He graduated from the University of Cincinnati College of Medicine in 1965. Following training in internal medicine at Syracuse and clinical pharmacology at Johns Hopkins University and the University of Rochester, he began a career in academic pharmacology and medicine at the University of Rochester. He began his work at the City College of New York in 1977, where his teaching included the topics of pharmacology, clinical pharmacology, and drug policy. Although best known to the drug law reform movement as the co-author, along with the late sociologist Lynn Zimmer, who just passed away last year, of the groundbreaking book Marijuana Myths, Marijuana Facts, which was published in 1997, Morgan had been an active force in drug law reform for decades. Dr. Morgan published approximately 100 articles, book chapters, and books on the clinical pharmacology of psychoactive drugs. More recently, his research and writing involved issues such as urine testing in the American workplace, medical marijuana, the socio-pharmacology of crack cocaine, alcohol prevalence during national prohibition, and physicians' prescribing practices. John was a wonderful man, a scholar, brilliant educator, lecturer, researcher, author, and a good friend to anyone who ever extended their hand to him. Every single one of us and around the world who cares about replacing prohibition-oriented policies with science, public health-based policies owes a man like John Morgan immense thanks and praise. We have a story from yesterday, the 21st of February 2008, out of Salem, Oregon, from the Associated Press. A bill to limit the use of medical marijuana in the workplace has gone up in smoke. The bill would have expanded an employer's ability to prohibit the use of medical marijuana by workers in jobs deemed hazardous by the Oregon Occupational Safety and Health Administration, including construction, law enforcement, forest services, and some manufacturing. Associated General Contractors, representing commercial construction companies, said the bill was needed not only to prevent accidents, but to keep construction companies from losing federal contracts for failing to abide by the federal workplace drug laws. The proposal, however, faced quick opposition from Civil Liberties Organization. It also failed to win backing from the Associated Oregon Industries, an advocate for Oregon businesses that supported attempts to pass similar legislation in 2005 and 2007. The lobbyist for the Associated Oregon Industries, J.L. Wilson, said this year's bill was too narrow in focus. He said, quote, "We feel this is a workplace issue that spans all sectors of employees, not just those in dangerous occupations," end quote, Wilson told the Portland Daily Journal of Commerce. Under Oregon's 1998 medical marijuana law, employers don't have to let patients with medical marijuana cards smoke in the workplace, but the law left it unclear whether employers must accommodate workers who use medical cannabis off the job. In 2006, the Oregon Supreme Court ruled against a registered medical marijuana user who was fired from his job at Columbia Forest Products plant after a urine test detected traces of the drug. But the court's decision avoided the central issue of marijuana use outside of the workplace. The two industry groups said they intend to work together next year for a more comprehensive medical marijuana bill. We'll have to fight against that. What they're saying is that they don't want to just limit industries that have dangerous side effects like construction, but they want to be able to ban medical marijuana from all workplaces in the state of Oregon. This story came out of the Associated Press, and it was published yesterday, February 21st, 2008. That's the end of our Hemp News segment for tonight, and we're going to go over to Mr. Tim Pate. How are you doing, Tim?
I am doing very well, Paul. I am. Thank you.
So how has your week gone?
It's always a nice week whenever you've got the flowers starting to pop up. All our crocuses are coming up, and the tulips are starting to pop through. And
yeah, we've had some sunlight.
Some sunshine here on the West Coast, and so that's always a nice thing.
That's true.
It just reminds me, here in about 6 weeks or so, it's about time to start putting things in the ground outside.
Yep,
so
the growing season's upon us.
Growing season's upon us again. So I think maybe we'll play some music and let them see what they're about to get in their gardens here.
All right, sounds good.
All right.
I'd like to introduce a couple of our guests here. This is Mr. John Murphy. How are you doing, John?
Doing good.
Good to see you. And Mr. Henrik Rowe.
Good evening, Paul.
Associate of mine, and we've worked together for a number of years. And John, you've been in our community for a few years now as well.
Yes.
And recently, is it your wife and you that have taken?
Yes, we've started our own online business. We do homemade patchwork quilts, as you can see. There's some samples of some lap quilts we do.
Yeah, let's take a look at the one that they've got on camera on the side here, on camera two.
Yeah, it's a lap quilt.
Scroll across that. I'm going to hold this up. You can't really see these too well on the screen because they're laying down here.
Oh, yeah.
Here we have one.
And we have aprons we make, and everything we make has a cannabis leaf on it. These take a little bit of time and pretty difficult to do because we hand draw them, cut them out, iron them on, stitch them with invisible thread, and then on the quilts, we quilt them. So we have our own quilting machine, and it's 100% washable.
Quilts are really nice. They look thick and warm, just like a quilt should be.
And we have a wide range of different sizes of aprons, so someone is tall or likes the extra long strings, it works out well for them.
That's good.
And they can visit us online to see the other art we do at Custom Ganja Art.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I think we'll have a little CG to pop across screen there. I know
there it is.
They were working on it.
That's
there.
Yours.
That's a different one. Well, they'll get it up there.
Yeah. But we have all colors and combinations. And different sizes. So if you're into art, if you're into pot holders as gifts or whatever, come give us a visit.
Pot-oriented pot holders.
Yes.
Kind of like that.
Yeah, that's nice. And if relatives come over, you can just flip them over.
Yeah. Hi, Julie. The wrong person comes in.
Yeah.
But
that never works.
No.
I've never seen that work.
Well, you know, it was that Crosby song, Almost Cut My Hair, wave your freak flag, let your freak flag fly there, or so they say. Hey, if you're out there and you want to call and ask John Murphy or Henrik Rode or myself any questions at all about ending adult marijuana prohibition, restoring industrial hemp, or helping medical marijuana patients, then you should call us at 503-288-4448. It is the 22nd day of the second month, February 2008. If you're not watching on February 22nd, 2008, don't try to call that number. But if you are, it's 503-288-4448. And we have a lot of different things going on in the coming weeks. I know this weekend, tomorrow, Oregon Normal has their meeting at Southeast 49th and Hawthorne, where medical marijuana patients, it's a cardholder meeting only. You have to be a member of Oregon Normal. But if you're not a member, you can join there on the site. But patients can get free marijuana at these. It's given away. Oregon Normal takes in donations from a lot of different sources, and then gives that away for free. No commerce is allowed at these events. And also, for patients looking for plants to get their garden going, they also have plants available. And so go on. If you're a medical marijuana patient, be sure to take your ID and your medical card in hand, and you can go to the corner of Southeast 49th and Hawthorne to the Mount Tabor Theater. And the doors close at noon, so you want to be there no later than 11:30. And I've seen a line going around the block of that place at about 10:30.
So, Paul, the meeting tomorrow actually is the Oregon Medical Marijuana Program 101 meeting.
Yeah.
And it's for people that are new to the program, where they can go and they learn. They have classes on different subjects every month.
Yeah,
and
last month they had one on teaching clones. I went to that one.
Yeah.
Got to be out of town, leave tomorrow. But
they've started doing those on the fourth Saturday of every month. And the second Saturday they have their regular meeting where they give out the starts and the medicine.
Starts and medicine at the other.
They do? They do both meetings now? Oh, that's great.
They do. But they also have the class.
Yeah.
Not many people really know about this one on the fourth Saturday yet. So the one we went to last, you know, the second Saturday is well known, and the word is out there, and there's about 500 people packing that place.
Right.
Fourth Saturday, it was maybe 150. It was a lot more comfortable, easier to get around, not quite as noisy. There's the contact information for Oregon Normal. You need to call them about anything or go to their website. Their website's a wealth of information. Is organized by Madeline Martinez and Russ Balville, who's appeared on the show too. I think we have a caller, though. Hello, caller. You're on the show. Hello, caller. Can you hear us?
Yes.
Good. We can hear you now.
Oh, hi, Paul.
Howdy.
Oh, I had a question. My father, he's an 80-year-old career ex-Navy guy, and he's recovering from a cancer operation. And he's losing weight. He can't seem to get his appetite back. I don't think he would smoke any pot with me. Kind of a conservative guy, but I'm just wondering if you had any advice on if there's anything from the cannabis plant that might, you know, not get him high and at the same time help increase his appetite.
Sure. You know, you can make compounds from the leaf that don't have much THC but do have CBD. And you can take it in a capsule form. We have a recipe on making those capsules. Or you can extract it in butter, oil, or an alcohol-based tincture. And so, depending on which one works best for him, there are several options available. We have recipes for those at our office as well.
Would a female plant be too strong for him, or would I have to use
it? I don't think so, no. You wouldn't want to give him the flowers. But the compound from the leaf would probably help. Taken orally, it's difficult. A vaporizer. If he considered vaporizing, that's a good alternative to smoking.
Right. Well, we'll give it a try if I can talk him into it.
I understand. Maybe have some cookies or brownies or an alcohol-based tincture. Does he drink at all?
He will been known to have a martini or two.
To have a cannabis-infused martini. There you have it.
That's a good
make
idea.
Make it with an extract with vodka and then our gin and make a martini for him. It's, it'll be a little green, but it might be helpful.
Excellent suggestion. I'll try it on St. Patrick's Day.
There you go.
It'll be a green drink on St. Patrick's Day. I like that. Good idea.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right.
Thanks for calling. Good luck with that. So if you're out there and you have a question for us tonight, give us a call at 503-288-4448. That's 503-288-4448. So in this past couple of weeks, you did a booth at the Lloyd Center. Henrik, how was that being in the Lloyd Center for 3 days, 12 hours a day?
Well, you know, it was like doing a trade show. And basically, we had a table there, and we were there to give out information. It was really, really fun. In that it was really very mainstream.
Right.
You know, we were there with Macy's and Friedlander Jewelers and right outside the Cinnabon store there for 3 days.
Oh.
That was
smell it.
A challenge.
How many times did you give in to the Cinnabon craze?
Let's see.
I went by and I'm happy to say I didn't give in once.
I did.
you got room
days.
For it.
But it was really fun because we were right out there. You know, with all these, this is very mainstream. We saw a very diverse section of the population. We had all ages and people all coming through the mall, and we were educating people and answering questions. We probably had conversations with 100 to 150 people.
We handed out about 1,000 brochures.
We handed out 1,000 brochures, exactly. And it was interesting, too, because the people, as they'd walk by, because you know how you're always looking for, when you walk by and somebody's trying to hand you something, you're always saying, oh, no, thanks, I don't want that. But they would hear the term medical marijuana, and they would do this complete 180 and come swooping back to the booth and say, what was that? Yeah, I want one of those. And so we got that reaction a lot. It was very interesting. And a lot of people didn't quite know what to make of it. They were kind of surprised to see us. And for a lot of people, it was just entirely normal that we should be there, and they were interested, and they wanted to talk to us about how do I go about it, what is the process for getting a card in Oregon or in different states. Of course, we had people from California and some people from Hawaii that stopped by to talk about how to get their cards there, and I explained that we have clinics in several states. We also had some people with not so enthusiastic reactions.
Yeah, they didn't like the fact that you were there.
They didn't.
That was rare, wasn't it?
It was rare, but not unheard of and not unexpected.
Yeah.
We had one couple that thought it was sad that we would be handing out this kind of literature in a shopping center where there were children present. Well,
hopefully they're educated a little bit.
And we had one fellow who was very upset that his brother-in-law was not paying his child support and was growing marijuana in his home with teenage children in the home. And he really thought our doctor should be responsible for his brother-in-law paying child support.
Doesn't sound logical to me.
No, but he was very emotional.
He was adamant, yes.
I asked if we could film him for our video clip just to let him give him 30 or 45 seconds to express, you know, his views to our audience, and he declined.
Declined to that. Yeah. Well, we'll show that here in just a minute. We have another phone call, though. Hello, caller. You are on our show.
Yes. My boyfriend has a card, marijuana card.
Right.
And I want to know if we're living together, if I can get in trouble.
No.
I can't.
Not at all.
Trouble?
No, you can't at all.
Okay, thank you.
What he's doing, if he has one of the medical marijuana permits, as long as he doesn't have more than a pound and a half of marijuana, which is a lot, seems like a lot to me, and doesn't have more than 24 plants altogether, then you don't have anything to worry about.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. That's a good question. A lot of people wonder about, you know, whether if I'm in the house, you know, what do I do? You know, they're supposed to post a copy of their permit at the grow site. So if anything's being grown, they would do that, or at least keep it with their stash or something if it was found. You know, there's a big event that we have coming up here on the 3rd of May. It's the Million Marijuana March, and it will take place in downtown Portland for the entire day of Saturday, May the 3rd. Oregon Normal is the primary mover and shaker behind that. They're going to have the entire Pioneer Courthouse Square downtown from 10 a.m. in the morning till the early evening. And so get ready for that. That's the 3rd of May, the Million Marijuana March. We also have our Hemp Stock Festival that we're gearing up for. That's going to be on the 6th and 7th of September. And we're going to do that on the East Bank between the Hawthorne and the Morrison Bridges. There's a little parking lot there that we have paid the city to procure. So we'll be there on the East Bank of the Willamette River, right across from downtown between the Morrison and Hawthorne Bridge. That's on the 6th and 7th of September, the weekend after Labor Day this year. And so if you're interested in being a volunteer or a vendor at that, then we have forms online and at our clinic. So just check out our website, hempstock.org, for that. It's hempstalk.org. We have another caller. Hello, caller. You're on the show.
Hi.
Howdy.
I was wondering if you could talk about quick maturing varieties that yield good. I've got a variety that yields good. Takes like 12 even to 14 weeks to really get fully mature, and so I'm just wondering what's out there.
Well, you know, the Northern Lights varieties, anything with that mixed into its background generally finishes out pretty quick. I found that our strawberry cough strain finished very early in the season. Didn't take more than 7 or 8 weeks.
What was the
train wreck
one?
Also finishes pretty quickly as well.
Train wreck. What was the second one again?
A strawberry cough. And I won an award, 3rd place. It was the first time I'd ever placed in the top three at the Oregon Medical Cannabis Awards here last December for that strawberry cough strain that we've grown organically outdoors.
Okay. In any future shows, you're going to talk about how you can... You were talking about how you got several pounds off one plant, and is there going to be any instructionals things?
Yeah, you know, we have classes that take place every Wednesday night at our office at 105 Southeast 18th Avenue. Those classes include beginning gardening, intermediate gardening, advanced gardening, how to make medicinal grade hashish. All of the plant-oriented classes require that you have a permit as a medical marijuana cardholder.
Yeah.
And so we do have one class, Understanding Oregon's Medical Marijuana Law, that doesn't require the cardholder, you know, that you show your card and be a cardholder. You can come into that one. But we have a series of, 7 or 8 classes right now, and we're considering adding additional curriculi to that thing. And so every Wednesday night you can find those on our website if you go out to thc-foundation.org. And you can get to that through hemp.org, which is our portal site. We have several different sites out there with our TV show, with our newspaper, with our clinics, and with our political initiative to end marijuana prohibition, the Cannabis Tax Act. You can reach all of those through hemp.org. That's a portal to the rest of our sites.
Who teaches those grow classes?
The fellow who was screened your call just now, Andrew, is the one who teaches those classes.
Do you have class to talk about doing things organically, too?
Oh, you bet. I only grow organically myself, and so we highly recommend organic growing. So certainly we cover that.
Are you hydroponic?
There's some organic hydroponic nutrients out there, and you know, we don't just focus exclusively on the organic line, though I personally favor that.
Okay. Thank you.
There's also these normal meetings on the 4th Saturday of the month. They're going to have classes in there. Last month they had a class on making cuttings.
Okay.
And it was a hands-on class, so you got to actually try it out and see how to do it. And I know they're going to have some class tomorrow. I'm not sure exactly what it is. But those classes are on the 4th Saturday, where we have ours every Wednesday night.
And this next Wednesday is a really popular one. It's making medical grade hashish.
That is always popular.
It's always a popular one.
Yep.
And my favorite one is the administering medical marijuana safely, where we talk about tinctures and capsules and vaporizing and all the alternatives to smoking.
Yeah.
That's next Wednesday.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for your call.
Bye.
Bye-bye. All right, well, we have that film clip we'll be running in just a second of the event down there at the waterfront.
At the Lloyd Center.
Yeah, the Lloyd Center.
Which
that's it.
Close to the waterfront.
The Hipstock Festival, that's at the waterfront. Medibles, that's one of the things. It's a nice cross between edibles and medicine. So that's what they call some of these cannabis-based foods or medibles. So you can find out more about that. So here's this film clip. Stay tuned. We'll be back in a second and enjoy. Job. You must have been up all night putting that thing together.
Oh, I just got my new computer, and it's got a little editing program on it, so you can
did a good job
take your
that.
Handy-dandy Sony cam out
those
to the place.
Those little cuts. I know none of that stuff happens quickly in most video editing programs.
Oh, it's fun, but yeah, it's a labor-intensive thing, like everything else that comes on the show here. But it was a fun event. I mean, the Lloyd Center, I mean, it was so... What we were doing down there is it was the health and fitness fair, which was interesting.
Yeah.
There were no banners.
It's neat they invited us.
I was watching. I was watching Channel 12, Good Day Oregon, to see if they had any big stories on the big health and fitness fair at the Lloyd Center. I saw nothing.
But we have to call them down there and tell them about it.
But there were several vendors, and what we did is we put up tables all the way around the ice rink. And so there was us, there was a couple of chiropractors, there was a physical therapist that we saw on the tape, he had a table there. The Fight Club had a table.
How does that really blend into health and fitness?
Fighting is a fitness thing where you jump around and you've got to be in really, really good shape, you know, and
punch the guy and don't get hurt yourself.
But anyway, we fit right in, being, you know, medical marijuana. We were definitely in the health and fitness range.
Yeah.
And the management, you know, we were kind of worried that they might find out that we were promoting marijuana use and have problems with us, but they were very cooperative and really helped us adjust our table to where we wanted it to be.
Great.
And so they were very supportive. Security guards, of course, they all loved us. They all thought it was great. One fellow we talked to again, he couldn't be on camera in uniform, but he was a veteran, and now he was working security at the Lloyd Center, and he just thought it was the greatest thing. He took a pamphlet and And we were handing the pamphlets out, too. We tried not to be real pushy and aggressive, but, you know, kind of talk to people, and if they wanted the information, we would give it to them. Mm-hmm. So it was a very, very positive response overall. It was great. Right.
Well, let's see. I know a caller's been standing by. Are you still there, caller?
Yes, sir. Good evening, Paul.
Good evening.
Hey, kudos to Fingers Pate over there for that last song he did.
That was neat, wasn't it?
Yeah, great finger picking. I like that. Quick question. The gentleman that was just speaking brought up a point about veterans. And I've been meaning to ask this question for a while now. If a person is a disabled veteran, or they're fighting with the VA and or Social
You're
Security
a disabled vet, aren't you?
Regarding disability.
Yes.
If that's
both,
the case.
Both John and I are disabled veterans ourselves. And I get a monthly check from the VA, and they paid my way through college for many years. And I know both John and I, much more so with John than I, but have worked in the past to aid veterans in procuring their benefits. I did that in a college level. John here's done that for state government, I think, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So having a medical marijuana card will not negatively impact your ability to receive veterans benefits, nor your ability to go to the VA hospital. In fact, we have some doctors at the VA hospital who refer patients to us. Also, I had sprained my ankle, which is one of the things that got me out of the military, in addition to tearing cartilage and ligaments in my knee and other things. But sprained my ankle and went in the VA hospital about 12 years ago, and they gave me Vicodin. And along with the Vicodin, they gave me a little warning sheet about interactions with other drugs. And it said on there that the interaction with marijuana was increased pain relief. And so you can, on occasion, get some honest information. And everybody has their own biases. So you don't know who you're going to talk to at any given time. A lot of people have been misled by marijuana prohibition and the war on drugs, but a lot of people haven't.
Well, my question regarding veterans, there are veterans in the system, including people coming back from Iraq with PTSD, which is not a condition that's recognized here in Oregon.
Right.
So if they're wanting to get their benefits for disability on that basis, is having an Oregon medical marijuana card going to adversely impact their ability to do that?
The folks who would ascertain the disability percentage will not know if the patient has a medical marijuana permit unless the patient tells the VA. And there's no reason to tell the VA people. Like I said, you don't know half the time if you've got somebody who's against it or for it.
Right.
And so it's best probably just not to bring it up. They're not going to do anything in that process where they determine your eligibility for disability, that's going to affect medical marijuana. They're not going to drug test you.
Well, the PTSD thing is something that's going to be very, very common, and yet it's something that we haven't yet gotten okayed here, but they have in California. What are we doing on that score, if I might ask?
You know, it's we've got to go into the health department and demand that condition be included. You know, we've often helped patients with hepatitis, but we found that some doctors are reluctant to sign for hepatitis, even though it causes chronic pain, it causes nausea, both of which are qualifying conditions, unless those issues are in their chart. So there's another thing that wasn't initially in the bill in Washington that the Washington Medical Association put in, and that is hepatitis. Here in Oregon, the only condition that's been added to the medical marijuana law since its inception almost 10 years ago is Alzheimer's and rage associated with Alzheimer's. And so it's a process of recommending that to the health department and following through and trying to get them to promulgate new rules to include PTSD. In the case of PTSD, we have the Israeli army that gives their soldiers cannabis for recovery from post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD. And there's a lot of other science behind that, but it's a matter of getting the state health department to include that or to change the law in some way.
depression would also be a good one to add to that list.
That's exactly right. You know, there's a lot of debilitating drugs that they use for depression, and cannabis is one of the least debilitating ones out there.
Another quick point I wanted to make while I had you on the horn, Paul. I didn't catch your news lead on tonight because I didn't get in the door soon enough, but Americans for Safe Access, who I know you're familiar with,
sure,
have a petition they're passing around to petition Oregon Senators Smith and Wyden to sign on as co-signers with the Kennedy-Kerry letter.
Yeah.
And they need something like 30,000 signatures by April.
Well, they do. So they think that number of signatures will make an impact with Wyden and Smith. You know, I know that here in Oregon, DeFazio and Blumenauer have co-signed the bill to add to allow the federal government to recognize state medical marijuana laws. And so that's a big one as well. But I know Americans for Safe Access is out there, and they're doing a lot of different work. They're largely funded by the dispensary systems in California. And so, but they've been doing work on behalf of patients and rapidly grown to one of the largest pro-medical marijuana groups in the country.
Yes, I've noticed their rapid growth. This particular petition that they're passing around is asking DEA Administrator or Acting Administrator Michelle Leon Hart to follow the recommendation of Administrative Law Judge Mary Ellen Bittner and grant a license to UMass Amherst Professor
yeah.
Lyle Craker to grow exclusively for federally approved research. Keywords
yeah.
being those last three.
Yeah, exactly. And they, so far the DEA has denied that. And, you know, there was another whole petition where the DEA was ordered by Administrative Law Judge back in 1988 to reschedule marijuana based on about a 500-page report, thousands of different scientists' input, and the DEA said there was no scientific basis for them to follow that recommendation. So, you know, they just lie and ignore the truth and ignore science and continue to get away with it. So I hope the petition makes a difference. I think the real key is changing the composition of our federal government and getting the Bush, baby Bush out of the White House will be a big step in that direction.
Amen, brother. I'm just fearful for our friend Obama.
Yeah, yeah. It's hard to say what's going to happen here.
Well,
but we can hope. You know, Obama and Clinton have both come out favoring medical marijuana research, but neither one of them have come out to favor changing medical to change and decriminalize marijuana or legalize marijuana. So where they might be helpful on a number of fronts, we can't look to them as our saviors on this movement.
This is true. The fact that we smoke herb medicinally doesn't mean that's the only thing we do in our lives, and so many people seem to think that that's what you do. You just sit around as a stoner, you know? So you're not a productive citizen. Well,
no.
Obviously, we know
pay
that's
taxes,
not true.
We take care of our families and pay our bills, too.
As well as some of us have opinions about the war that's going on.
Yeah, on both sides of the fence. You
March
know,
15th.
The use of cannabis doesn't mean everybody's into one ideology or the other.
No. But the fact that some of us are peaceniks, if you will,
yeah,
we make up a fair to middling percentage of the people in the Portland area that are anti-war. And
yeah.
on March 15th, there's going to be an anti-war rally down on the South Park blocks.
All right.
So
I know we closed down, when the war started, remember we closed down the highways and the whole city downtown Portland when that happened. So,
this is the fifth anniversary of the beginning of the war.
I see.
So it's a good time for us to, as you said earlier, let our freak flag fly.
Yep, yep, I agree.
And intermingle, shall we say.
Yep.
Hey, I appreciate your time. I know you got other callers coming on. Thanks, Paul.
All
have
right.
a good night.
Thanks for your call.
Uh-huh,
good
bye.
Question. Good set of statements there. Yeah, have you ever seen medical marijuana users discriminated against in federal disability?
No, never.
Never.
I don't know if anybody's ever
told the federal government that they were on the program if they were still trying to go through the disability process.
Yeah, I don't see where that would be useful at all. But I haven't heard any negative consequences coming
Never
back
have.
From that.
Just and I have heard of the federal VA doctors, some of them even suggesting there's alternative things available other than what the pharmaceuticals that they have available.
I'm going to reach over here and grab one of these. Now, how did you guys come up with the pot holders here? What was the...
Well, that was actually a mistake on my part.
Uh-huh.
I was started out doing a lap quilt for a nephew of mine that happens to be interested in cannabis products.
Uh-huh.
And I made him a quilt, and it turned out that I pinned it on this big machine in the wrong direction, so it ended up to where it was too short. When I got to the end, I had half of it done and half of it hanging out. So ended up having to chop it apart, so voila, pot leaves with pot holders instead of a quilt. So I thought, well, just make more pot holders. And that seems to be the most popular item that we have is pot holders and aprons. So
well, they just go together.
Yeah, they do.
Pot holders.
Yes.
You know. I don't really like the term pot overall, though, you know, because it indicates something that isn't true, that, you know, the term you're going to go to pot.
Yeah.
Generally, I eschew that. If I edit it out of any of our newspapers and our hemp news segment and instead use cannabis or marijuana, because I don't like the idea that somehow cannabis is detrimental or causes you to go to pot
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
True, but this has to be a legitimate pot.
It's got a funny little laugh there.
It worked.
So if you're out there and you have a question for us tonight, then you can call us at 503-288-4448. You can watch this show on YouTube anytime you want, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, no cover charge. There's the number if you want to call us, 503-288-4448. You know, there's a whole list of conditions out there that qualify for medical marijuana. The one that most people have and most people qualify with is chronic severe pain. Chronic severe pain accounts for 60 to 70% of the permits for medical marijuana in Oregon, Washington, Colorado, and Hawaii. And so also there's chronic severe nausea. There's AIDS and glaucoma, gastrointestinal ailments such as IBS, Crohn's disease, or GERD. There's seizure disorders like epilepsy qualifies, as do spastic disorders like multiple sclerosis and other neurodegenerative diseases like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's. Hepatitis causing nausea and pain qualifies for medical marijuana as well, as do all forms of cancer. So if you're out there and you or a loved one might qualify for medical marijuana and you don't really know where to turn to find a doctor to help you get a medical marijuana permit, we have dozens of doctors across the western United States that can help you. So if you're interested, here in Oregon, we have a physician referral line for medical marijuana. You can call us at 503-235-4606. That's 503-235-4606. Up in Seattle, we have a number. It's 206-878-1701. That's 206-878-1701. If you're in Denver, Colorado, the number in Denver is 303-403-9996. That's 303-403-9996. In fact, they say that this show is the number one cable access show in Denver, Colorado. You can watch it every Saturday night on cable channel 56 at 10 p.m. That's Saturday night in Denver, cable channel 56 at 10 p.m. You can call our clinic there at 303-403-9996. We just opened a clinic down in the Coachella Valley and the Inland Empire in Southern California, about an hour and a half outside of Los Angeles, at Riverside, California. The number there is 951-782-9898. That's 951-782-9898. And if you're outside of all of those major metropolitan areas, but you need help finding a doctor in Colorado, Oregon, Washington, Hawaii, California, Nevada, call us at 1-800-723-0188. That's 1-800-723-0188. We have another caller. Hello, caller. You're on the show.
Hey, how's it going? I have a little question for you. I believe that I would be able to be, a participant of the medical marijuana scenario, and I would love to grow within my household, but I'm afraid that, you know, suppose I get my name on this list and I do, you know, have the opportunity to grow in my home. Suppose that state law is changed and...
Well, then you would stop.
Well...
You know, they wouldn't be able to go back. What they do is they give you a permit from the state that says you can legally grow. And while you have that permit, you're legal. Where if the law changes, you could stop growing.
Yeah, all right. I guess that's fair enough. I feel it would be kind of weird to have my name up on a list where, you know, quote-unquote, the man could come in and check thereafter, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And,
well, I'll tell you, I've had my name on that list for about 8 years now, and it has not caused me personally any sort of detrimental impact. In fact, it has been beneficial in those cases where the police have found my marijuana. I've got to keep it. And I haven't had it taken away. And in fact, I even, at one point this past year, had the police at the door, and I let them go out in our backyard and count our marijuana plants. We were way under the numbers we could have theoretically had. I could have had 120 plants with the permits we had, but we only had 35. The police said, hey, you're way under your numbers, and they went away and left us alone. So I found it to be great protection. It beats being busted. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, a get-out-of-jail-free card. It's liberating, actually, to have these permits. You know, it's a big difference in your outlook on the world.
It's nice to be a fine, upstanding, law-abiding citizen.
Yeah, and to know that, you know, they can't haul me to jail for ganja. It's reminds me of that Peter Tosh song, I may not go to jail for ganja no more. And so, there you have it. That's what I say. I'm going to keep fighting. You know, we have a petition out there that's going to come out this summer, the Oregon Cannabis Tax Act petition, that will legalize the sales of marijuana to adults. If you want to grow marijuana for sale, you'll be able to get a permit from the state and sell it back to the state. The state will sell it to your community. And so, thereby, you know, making money. And if you just want to grow your own, you won't need a permit. And medical patients will be able to get cannabis at cost in pharmacies. So I can see ounces coming down to $5 or $10 an ounce for medical patients through pharmacies, where they tax it and sell it for a higher price for those out there who just want to buy it for social or recreational use, I guess they say. You know, you don't hear much about the recreational use of alcohol. Hear about the social use of alcohol.
Not
the recreational use. It's kind of a pejorative term to tie recreational to, you know, altering your consciousness, I think. And so I'd like to say the social use of cannabis. Or, there you have it, anyway.
Do you hear a lot about the medical uses of alcohol?
Not much anymore.
No.
I mean, there's a few.
Anesthetics.
There's that. And there's that once you're over 40, if you drink an ounce of alcohol a day or so, it's supposed to have a beneficial effect on your cardiovascular system.
Isn't that red wine?
Red wine, too, yeah. But the other forms of alcohol as well. We have another caller. Hello, caller. You're on the show.
Yeah, I'm wondering, how do you know if you got a cold, if the vaporizing is going to aggravate the cold symptoms? Because a lot of times I'll be at the tail end of like a cold or a cough or something, and I'll take a nice big vapor hit, and then it'll just put me right back to the
coughing's
symptomatic.
Bad. Well, then that's an indication that you probably should not be vaporized. When I have a real bad cold with the cough and associated, I usually lay off of it and say, you know, it's important to breathe. Breathing comes first.
So can you then
breathing is fundamental.
Can you go to tea, grinding
sure.
it making tea?
You can go to all sorts of medibles. And that's something I want to say. That class that Oregon Normal has tomorrow at the Mount Tabor Theater is on preparation of medibles, or oils and candies and foods and teas. And so that's what the Oregon Normal class is tomorrow, Saturday, the 23rd.
One other thing is, like, if you're into your growing moments, how do you clear it of all of the chemicals that you've been adding.
Oh, well, you stop adding anything. You just feed it straight water the last two or three weeks.
Oh.
You flush it with water, lots of water. And there's also a couple other things out there, magnesium, that'll help pull other sorts of fertilizers out of it. But yeah, you flush it the last 2 weeks for sure.
Oh, all right. Thank you.
And then that takes the chemical flavor out of it once you harvest.
What takes the chemical flavor out?
Oh, flushing over the last 2 weeks will pull the chemical additives and take that chemical fertilizer flavor out.
All right. Is that what gives you a headache?
It could. I mean, it might not, but it could.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah, I recommend stop all fertilization when you're 3 weeks out from flowering and then flush it with lots of water. And that's going to help.
All right,
then
cool.
You can take cannabis orally.
Yeah, I'd like to address that thing about the vaporizing and having the cough, because I've just gotten over a quick bout of bronchitis that took me a couple months to get over. And what I had to do is I had to quit smoking, of course, according to my doctor's orders, Dr. Orvald. And he suggested that I go into vaporizing, but I found that even that, with that dry air, was irritating my throat. And I went over to the capsules, and I know that our recipe calls for making the capsules out of leaves, which is really good because you heat it up in the oven and it activates the cannabidiols.
But that won't really get you high when it's made out of leaves.
No, it doesn't make you that high. But
I
like
you want the THC.
I use the bud.
Yeah,
it's not like I'm not smoking. It's not like I'm saving my bud for smoking later. So I've been making capsules following that recipe and making them out of the bud. I don't heat it up for 20 minutes, just for a couple of minutes, just enough to activate it. And I've been making the capsules out of bud and eating those instead of smoking at all. And I find that it really gets me through the day very evenly. It really helps with my back pain. Makes me able to function
at
work. But
well, you know what, Henrik? I'm going to have to cut you off because we're down to just about a minute left to go here. Is there anything you'd like to say in closing, John?
No. Thank you for inviting me.
Thanks for coming. And you can get your pot holders from John at his website.
Custom Ganja Art.
And thank you for coming, Henrik. And thanks for your hard work on behalf of medical patients and getting the word out. I want to thank our viewers for watching. And tune in next week and help us restore hemp. Tim, are you ready to take us out with a little tune?
Yes, I figured I'd cook.
You've got a nifty little schmuck there.
Yes, I do.